Saints and Tasty Cakes podcast. I'm Bert Lepore. He's Damian Monte Carlo. We're hanging here with Angry Mike D. And we talk about music, movies, and so much more.
All right, we're back with another episode of Mixtapes and Tasty Cakes, episode 78. This one we're going to review and rank each song on the latest Ghost record, Impera. I guess that's how it's pronounced.
Something like that.
So we're not going to talk about the instrumentals. I think there's two instrumental tracks, so we'll just skip over those, and so there'll be 9 total tracks, I guess, you know, as full songs with vocals. So we'll rank those starting from 9 down to 1 and share our thoughts on them. Overall, I mean, I listened to it a couple times when it came out, like a month ago, I think. And real solid record, man. I listened to it again today and went through each track. And man, it is really good. I mean, it kind of reminds me of, not that like it sounds like it or anything, but it almost reminds me of like a modern day Metallica Black Album, where like most of the tracks are good, and even that even kind of has like some of that production too in a way, which I wouldn't be surprised if they're kind of going for that, because I know he does kind of want to attain that sort of status. I mean, he's not afraid to be like, he wants to be like the biggest band on earth, you know. Tobias or Papa, whatever you want to call him. He said that in an interview. So, you know, I can respect that. He's not blowing smoke up anyone's ass. You know, he wants to be a rock star. And, you know, I liked them a lot more the past 3 records than I have. You know, it took me a little while to catch on. But this album, I think, really, you really hit a home run with this one.
Yeah. Yeah. Guess what? There's not a bad song on this record at all. Yeah, there's not a bad one. So even when we say number 9 or the worst ranking, it's not really even bad. It's still all good. Mm-hmm. The crazy thing this band does, man, and I've been following them from the beginning, is that especially now, I mean, they're pop songs with twisted lyrics that everybody sings along. Man, it's, you listen to the melody and you look at the lyrics and you go, I can't believe that's what he's singing, and everybody's into it. It's great. Yeah. It's such a twist. Mm-hmm. It really is. And they're probably one of the few real, real big shot rock bands out there right now that give you the big show. You know, there's not many that give you that big show. They give you a presentation. And I never seen them live. I know you have. I never seen them live. But, they're great. Even I watched the clips on YouTube and all that. Unbelievable. Definitely one of my favorite bands in the last 10 years. Definitely. Mm-hmm. And it's weird. You know, they started off kind of sound like Mercyful Fate, and they kind of had that kind of underground kind of metal thing going on. And each record, it kind of got poppier and poppier, but it's still good. You know, like it's like, I don't know. I would have said when I first heard this record, I'm like, oh, it's good. But it grows on you really, really, really quick. The more you listen to it, the more you love it. You know?
Yeah.
Mike, what's your thoughts overall?
I mean, I've heard of concept albums before. I can't say maybe if you go to like Guar or something like that, but this is like more like each album is part of a story, if I'm correct. Like, you're the big ghost guy here.
Yeah, it's the last couple.
So like, I would call them more like a concept band or a concept artist, you know?
Yeah.
Like, I don't know what the full story on this album is, or like, I kind of just listened to it as a whole. Like, I didn't really interrogate the lyrics or look at anything, but I think it's pretty damn good, from the production level to the song quality, you know, to the songs done on there. It's good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's my thing to like listen to all the time. It doesn't bother me when I hear it, but yeah, I mean, for what it is, it's pretty good.
Yeah. The one thing you will hear throughout a lot of ghost stuff is, you'll hear familiar things. It might not sound just like it, but you'll hear a guitar part that reminds you of something. There's one part in that song, Respite of the Spitalfields, whatever it's called. and it's got that White Snake that which is kind of like the White Snake part, you know. Yeah. And there's definitely familiar stuff there.
Man. I'm calling that. I think I'm more or less calling that the Faith No More part, but I don't know.
Definitely
that little bass riff. Right?
yeah, it's that stop and go guitar thing. And even like, you know.
Oh yeah, I know the song.
We listened to
that reminds me of Metallica a bit. That one.
Yeah, and Metallica. Yeah, sure. Now, did you listen to The Three Sides of the Coin with Larry Mazer this week?
No, but I listened to another podcast with him. It was a Kiss podcast. I feel like it was them, maybe a few months ago. Is this the second time he's been on?
Yes, yes.
Okay, so I saw the first one back in January or February, I think.
Yeah. And he talks about like Ghost being like, you know, because Ghost sold like 95,000 records in a week or two or something like that, and which is a lot now.
It's big these days.
Yeah, it's huge. Yeah. And, you know, it's like he's saying that's like they're the only band is that big right now that's moving the numbers in the rock genre, you know?
Well, it debuted at number 2 on Billboard Top 200, yeah. Which is pretty
it's pretty big. Yeah,
pretty impressive. Big. Yeah.
Yep. And you know, and hit number 1 on a bunch of the regular rock ones, but the Billboard 200, number 2.
That's the big one. I mean, yeah, I mean I used to be really into following all that stuff and I still check it out from time to time, but that's the one. I mean, there's like hundreds of different rankings now, which, you know,
it's weird.
we could probably have a top 10 record in some fucking weird category or something, yeah. You know, top independent artist in Philadelphia or something.
Yeah.
Billboard list, you know, some bullshit. But this is the top 200 is
fucking impressive.
That's the big one. That's yeah.
Yep. Okay, so
you never know. You could be big in Europe, you know, like David Hasselhoff or something.
That's what Damien wants. Damien wants to be as big as the Hoff. Big as the Hoff. So what we're going to do here, we're going to start out with our individual countdowns first. And we're going to start out with, you know, there's 11 tracks or 12 tracks, but we're going to go with the nine that are actually songs and not the instrumentals or, you know, segues. So coming in for me, coming in at number 9 is Darkness at the Heart. And, you know, it's a real good song, but it's probably the weakest out of the whole record, but it's still a really good song. His melody lines are great. You know, it's still good. So I can't even say it's bad. It's still really, really good. I just think there's better songs on it. Damo, what was your number 9?
Yeah, I had the 20s at number 9.
Yeah. It's
easily my least favorite.
Really?
yeah. It's just, it didn't do anything for me. But overall, I mean, I really, really like every song, but this one is clearly my least favorite.
Okay, Mike D?
I guess we're universal. You had the 20s, right?
Yeah.
Okay. I went with the same pick Birdhead.
The Darkness of the Heart of, yeah.
Darkness.
Yeah. Darkness in the Heart.
Yeah.
It's not that I hated it or nothing. I mean, I thought there was a lot of little cool. That was the one I was actually thinking of. It had that little Faith No More bass riff in there.
Yeah. Matter of fact, when you were listening to it, you mentioned to me, you're like, this could easily be a Backstreet Boys song if it was quicker. This was the song.
That's the ballad.
Is that the one?
It's the ballad one.
The ballad.
Yeah. I think it's a really good song. That's why I didn't put it at 9, but it's not on my list. It's not that far off.
Right. Okay, going in for number 8 for me, Respite, if I say it right, Respite on the Spitalfields. Really cool song, got a lot of neat stuff in there. It's got some Metallica kind of sounding things in there, a couple different changes. Really good song, but I got it at number 8. What about you, Dan?
I had that at 8 also.
Wow.
You know, again, it's a really good tune, but you know, it was better than the 20s.
It's weird. I actually like the 20s.
Me too. I like that one too. Mike D, what do you got at number 8?
I'd like
8?
Some 50s or 100s, but I'll take the 20s.
At number 8.
I had a Griftwood.
Oh, the old Griftwood.
Again, I mean, I don't think it was terrible. I mean, it was just, I might listen to it again and love it. It might be the best song on the album.
Right. Yeah. This album catches up to you, man. The more you listen to it, the more you like it. For me,
because the first time I listened to it as a whole, I was like, eh. And, you know, by second, third time, it started growing on me.
Yep. Okay, for me, at number seven, even though it's a really good track, it's got a lot of cool changes in it, a lot of crazy keyboard stuff, Kasarian. I like it. I just like other songs better. Damo?
Yeah, at seven, this is where I put Darkness at the Heart of My Love. Probably because it's a little too slow, but I still think overall it's a really, really good song. And I wouldn't be surprised if this is like almost like a breakthrough hit for him. You know,
it could be.
To kind of like break through to like the masses, you know, I can kind of see this being like a hit for them. You know, they'll probably even do some really cool visual video or something with it. But
they should.
Yeah, I think it would be a hit for them. But yeah, so I put this at seven.
Cool, Mike D, seven.
I went with three. Spite on the Spittlefield. Even that's a fun one to say.
Yeah.
So we're all pretty much in the same. Yeah. So me and Bert had that at eight, and you had that at seven.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's kind of like around the same realm.
Yeah.
Number six for me, Spillways. Really good song. Great lyrics. Really catchy song. Yeah, it's a pretty powerful song. It's really, really good. Damo, what you got?
I had Griffwood at six. I think it's a really cool, straight up hard rock tune.
D, number six.
I went with the Kasarian at number six.
No thoughts on it, just at number six, that's it.
You know, it was a good song. You know, let's just get out of the way. It reminded me of Kiss a lot. No. I just really? Wanted to, no, I just wanted to throw Kiss in there before you guys did. No, I mean, not too much thoughts on it. It was pretty cool. It's a cool song.
Yeah.
Okay. Number five for me, Griffwood. Ranked a little higher than you guys, I think. I kind of dug it. Really, really, really good song. Damo?
Five, I had Kasarian. At five. And dude, when I first put on this record, I was like, is this the same band? Because it's kind of like a real, like, kind of like happy up tempo song, but it's fucking catchy as hell.
Yeah.
I mean, that chorus is really catchy.
Yeah. If you read but the it words, it doesn't
sound like them at all, man. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, musically, it kind of starts out and it kind of reminds me of like, and I'm not even really a big fan of them for no particular reason, but kind of reminds me of the Darkness a little bit.
Oh.
I could picture that voice. Well, he comes in with that little high pitch kind of thing. Yeah. It's like the first thing he does, almost like a scream or something, like a falsetto thing. So it kind of reminds me of them.
I definitely hear the Who part, you know, in the beginning.
Yeah,
of it.
Yeah.
You know, and
right. Like the Bob O'Reilly.
The Bob O'Reilly, yeah. And it's got like even like a little bit of a Boston feel to it, you know.
Yeah, like, yeah, yeah.
It's an interesting song. It really is.
Yeah, it is.
Mike D, what do you got at number five?
I had the 20s. Which is probably the heaviest song on the album.
I think you're right. Number four for me, 20s. I love it. I think it's a great song. If you read the lyrics with it, it's really good. It's a lot of that tongue-in-cheek. He throws in some silly stuff in there, you know. We're in the 20s. We're counting our pennies. We'll be whatever. Fucking hilarious.
You know what I don't like in it about the song?
What's that?
What I don't like about it is what is the reason why I rated it so low at number nine is because I don't like those friggin' trumpets.
Oh, I kind of like that.
Come on, man.
That works for it, I think.
I don't like
you. Don't
that,
that's right. No. You don't like the trumpets, like, and shit like that. Yeah.
I don't know. You know what? Yeah, as a kid, I would have hated it, but like, sorry, you do it right, it gives that like majestic feel or something. Like,
yeah,
I don't know.
Yeah.
Like Mars Volta used the trumpets in there and it's fucking awesome. It's
they're
just
different.
Like,
yeah, they're different though.
It's like you're in outer space or something.
Yeah. But, you know, again, I don't dislike the song. It's just clearly my least favorite.
Right.
You know, of the album. And I like everything. So,
What do you have at number four, Dame?
Watcher in the Sky. That's another real catchy one.
Yep.
And Yeah, it's really good, man. This album is really just so great, man. When you going through this list, you realize like this is a great record. I mean, mm-hmm. even when the stinkers are good, you know.
It's a great record. Yeah, it's a great record. Mike D, 4.
I went with Spillaways. Kind of like a little Bon Jovi-ish kind of sound in it.
Oh yeah.
I mean, it's strange. It's like everything you heard before, like, well, especially like when you grow up in our, like, you know, in the 80s and everything like that. So it's like you heard everything, but it's like, so what? You know what? He's not just stealing one person's style. It's like, you know, it's an amalgamation of everything.
Right.
Yeah. It's like you put everything in a blender.
Right. But you know, if you're a fan of like rock and heavy metal from the 80s, you're definitely hearing your favorite bands.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Definitely. Like I said, they got a lot of earworms. It sticks with you, you know? A lot of these songs definitely mm-hmm. stick with you. Okay, coming in for 3 for me, Watch in the Sky. I love it. It's just huge. It's big. It's another song I think it could be a crossover hit. It's really, really, really good. The mm-hmm. melody line, the lyrics. I mean, I keep saying the same thing, but it's just that good. Demo?
I have Spillways at number 3. Easily one of my favorite tracks, man. It's a really good tune. Yeah.
Mike D?
I went with Hunter Moon. Hunter's Moon?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. For me, going on to number 2, Hunter's Moon. Me and Mike are like back to back. One up, one down. Hunter's Moon. They released this before the record came out, a couple months before. They did a video for it. It was for the Halloween movie that came out. Really good, man. And it's not what I expected for their first single. It was really, I mean, they're really treading that pop line, you know, in a good way. In a good way. Like, this guy knows what he's doing. Definitely knows what he's doing. It's pop melody, twisted lyrics. Great story. The story and the lyrics are great. He twists it all, you know, into this. It's this dark song that comes across as a pop song, which to me, that's the way to do it. You know, that's definitely the way to do it. Damo, what you got at number 2?
Hunter's Moon.
Same song.
I have it. Yeah. At number 2, it's really good. I mean, I think this and Hunter's Moon and Spillways sound the most like Ghost.
Yeah.
You know, I think it's definitely like follows their formula and sounds like them. I think everything else is sort of, they're definitely like experimenting a bit, but you know, it's still them obviously, but those two tracks, I think almost feel like they're written like a couple albums ago, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know if they were or not, but yeah, I mean, that's a really good, really good tune.
Mike D. Number 2.
I went with Watchers in the Sky.
It's a good one. It is a good one.
It kind of reminds you of a little Journey-ish or something.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm. I could hear that. I could definitely hear that. Okay, guys, for me, number 1, no doubt about it. This song is a friggin' hit. It's fucking great. It sticks in your head. I love everything about it. Even the video I love. Call Me Little Sunshine. Love it. What you got, Damo?
I got the same thing. Call Me a Little Sunshine at number 1. This totally sounds like Metallica. Like 1991 Black Album. Like I could see it like almost like coming like the next video after like The Unforgiven or something. You know, kind of reminds me. I can kind of see them doing that and, you know.
But Hetfield voice, yeah.
Yeah, I could hear Hetfield's voice, and I can kind of picture the video and everything. But that's such a great, great song.
Mike D, what do you got at number 1?
It's a Sunshine. We all went the same.
Wow, we only had to pick the hit.
Little sunshine.
So what I'm going to do here, I'm just going to run through the countdown real quick of what we did all together. We combined our numbers together and came up with, a master list. So at number 9, Darkness in the Heart of My Love. At number 8, Respite on the Spitalfields. At number 7, Kasarian. At number 6, Spillaways. At number 5, Griffwood. At number 4, 20s. At number 3, Watcher in the Sky. At number 2, Hunter's Moon. And at number 1, it's unanimous, Call Me Little Sunshine. So that's what we have for the new Ghost record. 20s? Yeah, 4, 20s. We all pretty much say it's a fucking dynamite record. It's a really good record. And it's about empires, about the falling empires and stuff like that. That's the concept. The more you hear the record, the better it gets. I mean, it's, you know, I could see Ghost going on they're on a tour right now, but they're going to be even bigger. They're going to be even bigger than what they are right now. And who would have thought?
Yeah, well, they're playing arenas now.
Yeah, I mean, who would have thought? You looked at the way they looked. Did you think they were going to be that big, Damon?
You know, honestly, it kind of didn't surprise me, and only for this reason. I remember when they came out like 12 years ago or whatever, people at work who probably don't listen to like metal, even though this, I mean, visually it's metal, but it's not like metal. But people that I know were not into metal were always talking about this new band Ghost, and they were playing the Troc. The first time they came to Philly, they played the Troc, and I think it was sold out. And it was all these people buzzing that generally are not into that music. So that really was telling. And then, you know, as the years, each album, you know, it just, you know, all these people were kept on, you know, going to see them and talking about them, that again, it wasn't their genre of choice. So that tells you that they have mass appeal, you know, and it doesn't, you know, really appeal to like hard rock metal fans. You know, it's a wider group of people, you know?
Yeah.
So it's, I'm not surprised.
How about you, Mike? Were you surprised that they're breaking through?
No, I mean, like, believe it or not, I only started hearing them like maybe like 3-4 years ago. And it's kind of a surprise, you know. You don't hear too much like big rock acts these days. So it's kind of good to see them kind of break in the mainstream.
Mm-hmm.
But no, it's weird. It's almost like too dark to break through, you know, where everything's like, you know, it's like, oh, yeah, I listen to rock music. Oh, yeah, what do you like, Coldplay? Like,
yeah.
That's, you know, that's like rock music these days. So yeah, it's pretty surprising to hear something like this breaking through.
Yep.
You like the Imagine Dragons? They really kick ass in concert. I hear now. Great rock act. Yes.
Who was that band, Dame? They just got accused of using tracks. Santa Cruz or something like that. Did you hear about that?
Yeah.
That thing.
Yeah.
Do you know that band at all or no?
Yeah, I do know them. In fact, that their first American show, their first U.S. show was in New York back in 2014, and I went. They played this little venue, and I thought they were good. They were, you know, they were pretty good because there was like a little buzz, and then they got picked up by like Universal Records, and they got on some pretty big tours and stuff, and. They played the Troc maybe like 5 years ago, open up for Sebastian Bach, and we hosted an after party, and we invited them to the after party that I DJ'd at, and they came, and you know, I met them then, but then the dude kind of like went off the rails, and he like his band kicked him off the tour bus, and then he went firing the band, and that was like 3 years ago, and he's had maybe like 4 or 5 different lineups since then. So it's pretty telling. So yeah, they played a gig at the Whiskey last week, and they're using backing vocal tracks. I'm not into that, the whole backing vocal track thing. I mean, if you have like a little keyboard part, an orchestral part, like, you know, before a song, but if you're going to do the vocals, man, if you can't do it live, then find a couple guys who could sing or whatever. But when rock bands, metal bands use vocal tracks, it's, I don't know, I'm not really into it. I mean, to each their own, I guess. But anyway, this dude did it, and he was having like lead vocal tracks in there.
Oh,
you know, which is, you know, if you're going to do it, you know, maybe backing tracks, backing vocal tracks, you know, but when you're doing the lead thing, man, that's bad. So I think the drummer fucked up. The drummer, I think, was like, couldn't keep up with the click, because yeah, you're got the headphones in and you're playing to a click, or else the vocals are going to be off. So the guitar player, like during the verse, the singer guitar player, he turns around and the fucking vocals are still coming through, and he's looking at the drummer, nowhere near the friggin' mic, probably telling the drummer, like, you know, dude, you know, keep up. Here, like, all the fucking vocals are coming through. It's like, dude, this is awful, man. And that happened for like two or three songs.
And this is a big blasted band?
I wouldn't say big. They're, you know, like a club act at this point, but, you know,
I don't think I've ever heard.
Yeah, they're not that well known, but, you know, you might see them at a festival. They're like way down on the festival and stuff. They've opened up for some big bands, some big tours. I can't remember who though, but they're younger guys, you know, late 20s, early 30s. You know, metal band from Finland. But they're good. I mean, they're definitely really good players. But the dude got blasted this week online by like Blabbermouth and you know.
Wow.
But on top of that, he's like being a total dick about the whole thing.
Really?
You know.
Wow.
So. Yeah, let's just like fighting with people online. It's like,
yeah, you can't get,
you know, and then he's saying that he meant to do it for publicity, and it's like, no, you didn't. Stop.
Like, I think if you're a band that goes out there and plays, like, and you don't have any show going on, dancing or choreography, or you don't have huge costumes on that's weighing you down, like, I think Kiss is real. I don't think they really fuck around with vocals and stuff, right?
Well, the last tour is a little.
Well, I mean, they're also in their 70s. Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah,
right.
But I mean, like, when you're young and you're going out there and you're playing rock music or whatever, that to me is like the phoniest you can get. Like, just if you're having a bad night, you're having a bad night. Just play fucking dirty or whatever. Guns N' Roses did it all the time.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Yep.
Yeah. But you know, I don't know. That's just cheesy to use tracks, in my opinion. You know, unless you're, like I said, you know, one of these pop bands that do stupid little dance acts and stuff like that.
Yeah. They've been doing it for years, you know?
Oh yeah. Yeah. I can't stand when you're watching a TV show or even like, and sometimes you have to do it, I guess, cause I guess they're not set up for it, when they have where they lip sync the song, when it's like, you know, if it's on like a, I don't know, I'm gonna say like a Jimmy Kimmel or one of those shows and they're lip syncing it. That sucks, man. You know, it's just,
they all do it. I mean, every single one, you know. I remember being young and seeing like Janet Jackson or whatever dance, and she had the headset mic, and it's like, man, she's moving around like crazy, and she's not out of breath, and she's singing every friggin' word. That's
not happening.
Yeah, that's a hell of a cardio she's got.
know, right?
Yeah, that's like, not happening. All right, guys. So I got one other thing after this, but what I want to do, I'm gonna wrap up the Ghost review here, and Damo, out of 1 to 5 stars. What would you rank this album?
I would give it 4.5.
Oh, 4.5, yeah. Mike D.
4.5, I would give it, yeah.
Mike D, what would you rank it? How many stars?
I'm in that realm. I'd give it like 4.25 to 4.75.
Come on, 4.5.
Well, I'll tell you what, to even
come
it
on,
out.
Give me a little more.
I'm going to give it a 4.75, so which gives it a Mixtapes and Tasty Cakes ranking of 4.5. That's it. That's that.
Bert loves the averages. He loves doing math.
4.5 out of 5 stars. Yeah, great record, man. Mike D went higher than I thought, too. Great. It's good. Good stuff.
Right. It's good. Not one of my favorite bands, but good stuff.
Hey, Mikey, he likes it.
Yeah. we gotta throw that in there some way. He likes it, Mikey. He sure don't like it. Get a thumbs up. Yeah. Okay, guys. Before we wrap up here, I know all three of us heard the song more than once. Dame, I'm gonna start with you. What do you think of the new Skid Row single, "The Gang's All Here"?
I love it. I really do. I mean, I was grinning from ear to ear when I heard it. I mean, I put a huge smile on my face because it's definitely they're going back to like what the people want, you know. And I like it when bands experiment, and I do like actually I think Subhuman Race is my favorite record, and that's probably like the most hated record because it's so experimental for them. But yeah, man, it's just like a great mix of like the first two records, and it's, I think the production is great, the songwriting is great, the playing, it sounds like them, even if it doesn't have Sebastian Bach on it.
Yep. No Sebastian, no problem, right?
Hey, you know, I mean, Journey's been really successful without Steve Perry, Foreigner. I mean,
yeah.
I don't know, there's definitely more bands out there that have, you know, that are still playing arenas and stuff with that the original singer. I mean, it's not their fault. You know, dude's a handful and he's a dick, you know.
So, yeah. Yeah. Mike D, what do you think of the new Skid Row song?
I mean, it sounded like it could have been off the first album or Slave to the Grind. It was a little, I don't know, cheesy for me. Like Gang's All Here. It sounded like something like it could be on the beginning of a sitcom or something like that. Like Friends 2.0 or something. I don't know.
Yeah.
It wasn't terrible for what it was, but it's just not my cup of tea these days.
But admit it, you thought it was Sebastian. You didn't know it wasn't Sebastian.
I did think it was Sebastian. He sounds like early Sebastian.
Yeah.
Like to a T.
Yeah. I loved it. I listened to it a couple times, and actually I listened more than a couple times. Once you get through the title of the song, it's great. Yeah. It sounds like the first Skid Row record to me a lot, like a real lot. It totally brought back.
And I wasn't a fan of his first record. I like Slave to the Grind, and that was about it.
First record's great. The second record's unbelievable. And the third record is pretty damn cool. You know, that's
how, I mean, don't get me wrong. It had a couple, the first one had a couple good tracks off of it, but to me it was like Slave to the Grind was just like in your face.
Oh, it was brutal. That was a brutal record. I mean, we're eventually going to do a show, I'm sure, on them. But the thing I like mostly about the new Skid Row song is that Skid Row's done stuff. They haven't stopped. They've done stuff through the years and put some stuff out, but I never seen them since the big albums push something new. And it looks they're really going, not hard like this. Like they didn't push. Like push. Like they're really going to push this. I think they're really going to take a shot at it again. And I think they deserve it. You know, I mean, great songwriters. I mean, man, they all stuck together pretty much with the three main guys stuck together pretty much. And, you know, it's Rachel and Dave's thing, you know, and whatever the deal is with Sebastian, I don't know, but he missed out on this, you know, because this young kid's pretty damn good. He's really, really good. And it's, man, it sounds like Skid Row. That's the best way I can put it. It sounds like Skid Row.
He doesn't have the look, though.
Yeah, well, nobody's got the look anymore.
No, you know? That's right. Yeah.
But the guys they had previous to him, you know, had the look, but they didn't have the voice.
I think that might be part of the problem, too. Like, that, you know, all these rock stars today are just T-shirt and jeans.
Yeah. Yep. Unless you're Ghost.
But, you know, they've always been a T-shirt jeans band.
Yeah, they never really got dressed up.
They never wore costumes.
No.
Stage clothes, you know.
Yeah, they've been pretty much
like what they would
wear regular. Yeah. Yeah, they were one of those more gritty bands, you know.
Yeah.
They got thrown in that kind of era. Besides some of the songs, they got thrown in that thing because the way they looked, you know, and not the way they looked, the way they dressed, just the way they looked. They had the real long hair. They had the front man that was 6'3", 6'4", that was about 85 pounds at the time. The chicks loved them. And that was just...
And there was a chance you know, you were going to get your ass kicked.
Yeah, but they were ballsy. they were ballsy, man. But if you look at David Snake Sabo, he's looked the same for 35 fucking years. He didn't look much different. He dressed the same way, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So, new Skid Row. I love it. I'm looking forward to the record. I think the record don't come out till like near the end of the year, like November or something like that.
And, yeah, October.
October, here you go, October. Yeah. And, man, I really hope that they try and push this through the roof. So I think it's got potential. I really do. I really, really do.
Yeah, well, they got a really big name producer behind them. Not like, you know, not a guy from years past, you know, that's like a current producer.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
that definitely gives them a little more clout, Like, it doesn't look like it's a nostalgia thing, you know.
Hey, look, and you got to give them credit. They had a billion chances to probably do reunions and got offered a ton of money, and they turned it down.
Oh, yeah.
You know, yeah,
they've had offers, and
you got to give them credit, man, for that.
Yeah, I mean, from what I've heard from them in interviews with them is that they said that, you know, they got as far a couple years ago with, like, they couldn't get past even a texting conversation with Sebastian, and that was like, dude, if we can't even have a little text thing going on with him, you know, it's not going to work in person.
That's crazy. Because they were pretty damn big, you know, and they would have stood around. I thought they would have stood around the way they were changing their style of music. They would have stood around. I think they definitely would have stood around. And even like Nirvana, you said,
killed everything.
Yeah, but guess what, man? I'll still say, I'm sure we'll talk about it down the line. Nirvana,
except for Metallica.
Nirvana, I don't think Nirvana would have been as big as they are now if, you know, after three more albums. I don't think they would have missed it. Yeah.
No, they definitely wouldn't have been. I definitely think if they were around, they wouldn't have this cult status that they have right now.
No way. Yeah, you're right. No way.
He's probably rolling around in his grave that, you know, you could buy a Nirvana shirt at Walmart, you know?
Yeah.
No, he would have been signing autographs at Walmart if he was alive. Like, yeah, you know.
And that's where
come on.
And that's where you got to give credit to Dave Grohl. Dave Grohl totally reinvented himself. He really, I'm sure he had some leverage with the Nirvana thing, but he really didn't push it. The drummer for Nirvana is in this band. He just did his own thing, and it just happened to really take
pushed
off.
It. They definitely pushed it.
I don't think they did.
They did, absolutely, because that's the only reason why I knew who the Foo Fighters were, because I was hearing the Foo Fighters, and then, like, I would always see the album and, like, ads and stuff like that back in the day, and then when I was watching MTV one day, here we got some Foo Fighters, you know, Dave Grohl used to be in Nirvana, and I'm like, okay, because I think it was that Mentos when they did that video, okay, I think what the song was.
Early one.
But yeah, like, they pushed who they were. They didn't really...
But he never falls back on that.
But the, you know, when you see in the interviews and stuff like that, they used to push it, but he never was really like a big.
He doesn't have to.
No,
I mean, he doesn't have to. He created his own destiny.
He did.
You know, he doesn't have to go back to doing that or do like Dave Grohl plays Nirvana tour or something. You know what I mean?
Right. You don't hear them playing, Smells Like Teen Spirit or nothing like that. Yeah.
Their music sounds nothing like Nirvana.
Nowhere near it. Yep. Which is, so I say, I mean, good for Dave Grohl.
He didn't write any of those. Yeah, he didn't write any of those songs. He had, you know, he was too scared to submit songs, you know?
Right. Probably good for him in the long run, though. You know? Yeah. Probably good for him. All right, guys. Mixtapes and Tasty Cakes. We'll see you next week.